Hello, this is Professor Kitch, and welcome to this webcast on section 9.3, which covers Mohr circle analysis. When you finish this module, you should be able to plot a Mohr circle given stresses applied to a soil element. Once you've properly constructed the Mohr circle, you should be able to determine both the magnitude and orientations of the principal stresses, as well as the magnitude of the maximum shear stress and the orientation of the planes on which the maximum shear stress acts. And finally, you should be able to use the Mohr circle to compute the stresses applied to any arbitrary plane using the pole method. To explain why the Mohr circle can be important to geotechnical analysis, let's consider a point at a slope below a slope, as shown here, point A. Initially, we might know the stresses acting on the horizontal and vertical surfaces of this point as shown. However, it might be important to know the stresses acting on some other planes at point A. For example, we might be analyzing a potential sliding surface on point A, such as one like this. And then we might want to know the stresses acting tangent to that circle, such as those on plane B here. If we know the stresses acting on the original surface, we should be able to calculate the stresses acting on this other set of planes. And we'll use the Mohr circle analysis to do this computation. The Mohr circle is a graphical representation of the stress at a point in a solid. It's drawn on a graph such as this, where the x-axis represents normal stress and the y-axis represents shear stress. In geotechnical engineering, we define compression to be positive because soils are generally in compression. This is opposite of the sign convention in most other disciplines of engineering, which assume tension is positive. And it's just one of the many ways in which geotechnical engineers are special. First, we will use the known state of stress in the XY coordinate system to draw a Mohr circle. The process is pretty simple. First, we'll draw the stresses acting on the X plane. That'll be sigma x and tau xz, where this represents sigma x and this represents tau xz. You'll note in this drawing that tau xz is positive. That's because this shear stress tends to rotate the element in a counterclockwise direction, which is what we defined as positive shear stress. Next, we'll plot the stresses acting on the z-plane, shown here as sigma z and tau zx. Next, we'll connect these two points with a line. That line will be the diameter of the Mohr circle, and we'll use that to draw the Mohr circle. The center of the Mohr circles represents the mean normal stress, and we'll discuss that a little later. And using Pythagoras' theorem, we can compute the diameter of the circle as the square root of sigma z minus sigma x squared plus twice tau zx squared. This represents twice the maximum shear stress at the surface at point A. Every pair of points opposite on each other on the circle represents two orthogonal planes in xz space. So all of these pairs of points represent stresses on planes at point A, but with different orientations in the XY space. And the coordinates of the pairs of points represent normal and shear stresses on those planes. It's important to point out that the Mohr circle is in sigma tau space and not XZ space. In the Mohr circle plot, the horizontal axis always represents normal stress sigma, and those y-axis represents shear stress tau. These are not the xz directions in the physical space. There is a relationship between the location of points in the Mohr circle and xz space. That relationship is best understood by the pole point or origin of planes. The pole point is a special point on the Mohr circle that can be used to determine the physical orientation of stresses acting at a point. In its formal definition, the pole point or origin of planes is a point P on the Mohr circle located such that any line drawn from that point will intersect the circle at a point D, which represents the stresses acting on a plane parallel to the line connecting P and D. Or said another way, a line drawn from any point D on a circle through the pole P will be parallel to the plane on which the stresses represented by that point D act. These definitions of the pole point, while completely accurate, are hard to visualize, and the concept is best illustrated by an example. Here is the Mohr circle we just constructed. The point X on the Mohr circle represents stresses acting on the X plane, and the point Z on the Mohr circle represents stresses acting on the Z plane. If we start at X and draw a line parallel to the plane on which those stresses act, that is, a vertical line, it will intersect the circle at this point here. Likewise, if we start at Z and draw a line acting parallel to the surface on which the Z stresses act, that is, a horizontal line, it will intersect the circle at the same point. That point is the pole point, or the origin of planes. Any line drawn from point P will intersect the circle at a point which represents the shear and normal stresses acting on a plane parallel to the line drawn. One way to illustrate the pole point concept is to extend one of the lines beyond the end of the circle and then draw your soil element with one side along the extended line. This soil element will now be oriented correctly in the X and Z coordinate system. As shown here, this element has one side parallel to the line extended from the circle through the pole, and is oriented with sigma z acting on a horizontal plane and sigma x acting on a vertical plane. We can use the Mohr circle to determine the magnitude of the principal stresses and the orientation of the principal planes. We know from our engineering mechanics classes that the principal planes are those where there is no shear stress. They are also the planes where the normal stresses are at maximum and minimum values. There are only two places on the circle where the shear stresses are zero. They are the points where the circle intersects the horizontal axis. The point on the right represents the major principal stress, sigma 1, with zero shear stress. And the point on the left represents the minor principal stress, sigma 3, again with zero shear stress. To determine the orientation of the principal planes, we start at the pole point P and draw a line through the point of maximum principal stress. The line is parallel to the plane of maximum principal stress and forms an angle beta with respect to the horizontal. If we draw a soil element along this line, it will be oriented with the principal planes, and the major and minor principal stresses will act in the direction shown. If we want to measure the direction, we simply place a protractor on the Mohr circle plot and read off the angle, which in this case is 18 degrees. Since the Mohr circle is a graphical method, it is important to understand that it must be drawn to scale. Today it's easy to draw a Mohr circle using CAD software and ensure that it is properly drawn to scale. We can also use the Mohr circle to find the shear and normal stresses on any arbitrary plane. In this case, we wanted to know the stresses acting on the A and B planes. To find these, we simply draw a line parallel to one of the planes we want, in this case the A plane, which forms an angle of 31 degrees to the horizontal. We then draw a line from the pole point at the same angle. That line intersects the circle at point A. And the stresses at point A will represent those acting on the A plane. Similarly, if we draw a line from the pole normal to the first line, it will be parallel to the B plane and intersect the circle at B, which will represent the stresses acting on the B plane. A line connecting A and B will be a diameter of the circle and pass through the center, indicating that these two points represent stresses on orthogonal planes. You can also use formulas to compute the principal stresses and the stresses on any arbitrary plane. These formulas come from your textbook, as shown by the equation numbers on the slide. Both the formulas and the Mohr circle graphical solution should give you the same results. Finally, I'd like to briefly discuss the concept of a state of stress and stress invariance. Here we see the point A under our slope and the two different orientations that we have been discussing. These two orientations are also shown on this Mohr circle diagram. Now the soil at point A is unconcerned about our choice of axis system. It is under a certain state of stress, a combination of normal and shear stress. It doesn't know the XZ system from the AB system. Those are arbitrary orientations chosen by us. The soil doesn't know or care what axis system we use to define our shear and normal stresses. It is under a single state of stress, and that is the same regardless of our chosen axis system. It follows, then, that we should be able to describe the state of stress of the soil at A by some values that don't change as we change our axis system. We call these special values stress invariants because they are invariant to our selection of axis system. So let's think for a moment. What's not changing in our Mohr circle as we rotate from the XZ axis system to the AB axis system? If we think about it, it's obvious. The Mohr circle itself isn't changing. The points we're selecting on the Mohr circle are changing, but the circle itself isn't changing. That's what's invariant, the Mohr circle. Specifically, that means the location of the center of the circle doesn't change. This point represents the mean normal stress, sigma m, and is equal to the average of the principal stresses. This is the average compressive stress that the soil is subject to. The other value that's not changing is the radius of the circle. This represents the maximum shear stress that the soil is subject to, and it's equal to 1/2 the difference between the major and minor principal stresses. The quantity is also called the deviator or deviatoric stress. So these are our stress invariants, the mean normal stress and the deviatoric stress. No matter what location on the Mohr circle we pick or what axis system we use, these don't change. You should now be able to draw a Mohr circle and compute the stresses on any planes. Here's a practice problem you should complete before class. Given the stresses on the X and Z planes shown, draw the Mohr circle for this state of stress and then compute the following values. You should use both the Mohr circle solution and the equation solutions given, and then check the results you get from each method. You can also check your solution against example 9.1 in your text. Again, do this before class. That's all for this webcast. Bye now.